Hello and welcome to Talking Heads in association with the Actors Center, New Filmmakers Los Angeles, and Movie Maker Magazine. My name is Danny De Lillo, and we're here at the Cambridge Los Angeles showroom in West Hollywood. And I'm here with the very multi-talented John Hindman. John, thank you for coming down today.
Thank you so much for having me.
It's awesome. I don't even know where to start to you because you've done and achieved so much. But tell us how it all started.
You know, for me, it really started when I saw Rocky.
Rocky.
I was 10 years old, and my parents took me to see Rocky. And I mean, I'd seen a lot of movies up to that point, but I didn't know the power that movies had to reorganize my very spirit, my soul, change me on a cellular level. That combination of theme and picture and story and light and music, certainly. I was one kid when I walked into that theater, and then I was a completely different kid when I walked out. And I remember I would save up my allowance every week. So I got enough to like take different members of my family. Like, you have to see this. You have to see this, you know?
Wow.
And back then, movies stayed in theaters for longer. Mm-hmm. And I just knew that I wanted to be a part of that. I didn't know what that meant or what being a part of it would mean. I just knew that in some fundamental way, I was that, and I wanted to figure out how to be what I am.
So how did, I mean, firstly, actually, I love the fact that your son is just as excitable about Rocky as you are. He's a fantastic kid. On top of that as well, how did Rocky move you into stand-up comedy?
Like I said, I wanted to be a part of that world, and I really wanted to make movies. I really mm-hmm. wanted to direct films. But how do you get anywhere from where you are? Mm-hmm. What is the route? Mm-hmm. I went to college, and just through a series of events, I found myself in this talent show, mm-hmm. in quotes, you know, talent, doing stand-up comedy, and somehow I won that, and then other schools came and they're like, we're going to look at people to come and perform at our school. And so mm-hmm. like, I was like 20 or 21 years old. Mm-hmm. And all of a sudden I was doing stand up at all these colleges. Mm-hmm. Not stand up that I'm proud of. Let me be clear.
But you won, so you must have been pretty good.
I think there was even a suitcase of props.
Oh, really?
Then. Yeah, it was rough. but my, for me, whether it's making movies or writing screenplays or doing stand-up or teaching class, there's something inside of me that I want to get out, mm-hmm. and not just to get rid of it, but really to share it, so that you feel what I feel too.
I love that, and I think that is such an important point, because you know you say you found yourself like doing this, and you know, most people, filmmakers, creative people, just also find that need to just get it out, you know, and you've got it out in a big way, and been very, very successful with it. So like, you know, you went into stand up, and then how did it? Did you get more into writing from that point, or how did it work?
You know, it was not. It's not a clear or easy path. I liked stand up, and I was decent at it. Yeah. My hope was that I would be funny and people would come and see me, and then I could be on a TV show, and then I'd be on that TV show for long enough that they'd let me like direct some episodes.
Yeah.
Right? It was like the longest, most impossible route to directing ever. That didn't work out.
Yeah.
That's not what happened. What happened is I was just a struggling actor and stand-up comedian who was getting fired from a lot of restaurants for, we'll call it a bad attitude. and I was, you know, geez, man, I was 34 years old, and I didn't know what to do. You know, I still had that same feeling that I had when I was 10, that I think that all artists have, where, again, not to get it out, but to share it with somebody else so that we both feel it.
Right.
You know what I mean? Like, I want you to feel what I feel so that I don't feel it alone. Or I have this idea in my heart that that I need to share with you so that it diminishes the this is a crazy phrase.
I love it. Tell it to
artistic
us.
Isolation, I think, that we can feel when our hopes or our work goes unseen, unheard. So what to do next, right? The stand-up comedian thing didn't work in terms of me being on a show that would let me direct it. and I thought, well, I'll start writing screenplays because it's the only thing I don't have to ask permission for. Like, I don't need an agent for that.
Now, that's, you know, it's wonderful because I think most people feel like they're supposed to have everything laid out and done by the time they're a certain age. And we all, creative people, always put that pressure on. So, I mean, it's a delight
that's,
that, you know.
That's the hope.
That's the hope, right? Enjoy that. It's vodka we're drinking, right? I'm just kidding.
Mine's gin.
It's just great. Yeah. But no, it's interesting, isn't it? Because, you know, it's at 34 years old.
Yeah.
And, you know, you suddenly, you know, you get your call and like, I'm gonna write. And what's so fantastic, what is the ingredients or what is it that actually, from the writing that you made, that actually turned it into be very successful?
I was, I met this guy who had written a screenplay and he's like, I think it's pretty good. What do you think? And I read it and I'm like, you know, I think that if we did this or move this piece here or if this was a little clearer or sharper, that it would be better. And I had a sense, I suppose, for how movies work. Because I can't tell you what movies mean to me. I mean, even being a kid, like I would, in the newspaper, if there was an ad for a movie that just like even looked cool, I would cut it out and tape it to my wall. And so my whole bedroom was like newspaper clippings, but just for ads of movies that were in theaters. Wow. Like, I was surrounded by it, you know? Wow. So I feel like I have a sense or a love for it. So he let me work on that screenplay with him. And then a guy who's a director was looking for pitches for a movie, and we pitched a couple things to him, and he paid us to write this script. And then after that, I decided I didn't really want a writing partner. And I'm really answering your question, I swear to God.
Oh, it's okay.
As opposed to just like a chronology, you know, like an endless litany of, you know, minutia. So I started writing on my own, and what I decided to do was I decided to rewrite Manhattan. And I know that sounds crazy, because it is crazy.
The legendary Woody Allen movie.
Correct, correct. I just wanted to, I can't tell you why. Not that I could improve on it, that isn't my point, but it was in writing that, a thing that no one asked me to write, that I wasn't gonna give anyone, it was in writing that I found my, I hate to say this, voice.
It's okay, you found your voice.
Yeah, good, I did. I found my voice. I figured out like how I write, which was as important as figuring out what my voice is, what my voice was when I was doing stand-up. Mm-hmm. My particular point of view, my perspective on life, you know, like an opinion or a feeling or a thought that you couldn't get from anyone else, whether you like it or not.
Yeah.
And I felt that was, that rewrite of Manhattan was successful in that sense. And my hope was that one day I would write a screenplay that was good enough that I could hold people hostage and they'd let me direct it. You know, they would have no choice, just like Rocky.
You need to copyright that quote. That was great. That was wonderful.
My trademark attorney is waiting in the car, so
oh,
I think,
perfect.
Yeah, we're good.
This is great. And so you did that, and what happened?
Well, again, you know, with that screenplay, which was called The Dream of the Romans, I was writing a screenplay for myself that nobody asked me to write, that mm-hmm. I didn't know if anyone was going to read. Mm-hmm. And I thought my family would like it.
Yeah.
Like, they would really get all of the jokes and they would relate to all of the people. It was so personal. And I don't mean like emotionally vulnerable. I just mean like every choice in there was something that meant something to me, mm-hmm. whether it's movie monsters or Chet Baker or my take on New Age spirituality or the questions that I have about like a higher power, like, you know, how do you reconcile yourself with a God who's silent?
Yeah.
These questions that are, again, like a personal point of view or mm-hmm. perspective. Mm-hmm. So I wrote it and I thought that it was pretty good. I thought that it worked as a story. And I had stand-up managers and I gave it to them and they're like, yeah, this is good. That's it.
And it happened.
No, nothing happened. Nothing happened for like, I don't know, almost a year. And they had a meeting with this producer named Kevin Messick. And they were interviewing him to like, hey, maybe you could come and run our film arm. We want to kind of promote and develop films within the management company. Mm-hmm. End of the meeting, they're like, one of our clients wrote this. You know, we think it's pretty good. Just that, just like in the most dismissive fashion possible. Just, you know, we found this lying around, and you know, if you have a chance, you should take a look at it. No, it was
not quite as glamorous as you would believe it to be, right? Yeah. No.
And he read it and he liked it and he called me and we met at Cafe 101, and I said I really want to direct this movie, and he said, okay, let me do my best for you, and within like a couple of weeks, I was the guy that wrote The Dream of the Romans. Like, I was getting emails at 2 o'clock in the morning from agents, like, this weekend we're sending it to this insert unbelievably famous person's name here. And what's important to me about that story isn't the Cinderella aspect of it, but the idea that it's the same script that had been sitting around for like a year.
Yeah.
And it just got into the right person's hands. I didn't change it. I didn't change anything about it, you know? And in fact, the version that we went into production with was only like the second and a half draft.
Yeah.
You know? It didn't really ever change. It's getting it to that person who not only likes it, because your mom can like it, but knows what to do with it. And just because you haven't gotten it into that person's hands doesn't mean that it doesn't have value or merit.
And you got it in some pretty valuable hands. How did you come about your cast?
Well, you know, we were lucky because that script ended up being on the blacklist and got a lot of attention in a town where it's hard to get noticed. And I had a pretty clear idea of how I wanted to proceed with hopefully putting this together. And mm-hmm. Kevin Messick was an invaluable part of that. As typically, you write something and people like it, and they say, we want to make this movie, and so here's the budget, but like we need these people. So they sort of force their idea of who will help make the movie successful, or at least break even, which I totally understand. You know,
I think
movies are really expensive.
Realize that, you know, a lot of films just, they want it to just break even, if anything,
right.
You know?
Totally.
So yeah, so that happened, and then...
But I decided to not do that. I wanted to pick the people that I wanted to have in the movie, and see if anybody wanted to pay for that.
And so, who did you get?
Jeff Daniels.
That the one of the most iconic Hollywood stars.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Lauren Graham, mm-hmm. Lou Taylor Pucci, Olivia Thirlby, Tony Hale, Kat Dennings,
and
Nora Dunn, who's great.
I think that's what's so iconic is that from this whole story you just told us is that from your voice, your crazy idea,
yeah.
And then what is that feeling like when you then have when you were just, you know, coming up with this master plan of a script and then you have like these incredible people up there, you know, acting your words.
I don't know that it can really be expressed with language.
I love it.
Yeah, but it can be expressed with dance.
Oh, okay. I didn't expect this. We have a little dance. Is that what's happening?
No, because it's a surreal feeling. You know, here's these characters that I wrote that I cared about so much that reminded me of people in my own family. Who I love as if they were real. And then to watch them become real in the hands of experts it's as humbling as it is thrilling, you know?
I think the journey you're describing is so wonderful because I feel, you know, it's hard to scope as a writer to kind of go through the whole, there's such an incredibly long journey. You know, you said you left it for a year. It wasn't like it was this conveyor belt to success and it all just went like that. But then, you know, at the very end of it, what happened was a great film. And, you know, you had these iconic people in your film. And on top of that, I mean, what is it like then that, you know, something you've grown up with that it gets selected for one of the biggest festivals in the world, in Sundance?
Before I answer that, let me say this, which is important to me, and that is, at every step along the way, and hopefully you're hearing this in what I'm saying, that it's important to have partners in that process. And I don't just mean partners in the way that we think of partners, like, hey, hand in hand, we'll walk down this road together. What I'm telling you is, like, I'm no good on my own. Like, on my own, I can't do much. You know, I need all the help that I can get. And whether it's the set PA, or the people that are paying for it, or the production accountant, or Jeff Daniels, who, like, works so hard on the script that, like, I can hear the punctuation that I wrote. Like, that's how specific he is. You need all of those people, yeah, all along the way, and that's why I don't have a film by credit on that, because it's not a film by me. It's written and directed by me, yes, but it's not a film by me. It's a film by, like, like 120 people,
right?
Most of whom will not get the opportunity to sit on a couch with you and speak about that process, who are unsung but no less important than I. To be selected for Sundance, I mean, that's like a hope, but it's like, well, it's just a hope. You know what I mean? You go like, well, that'd be nice. You know, like, sort of like being taller is a hope. You know, like, well, I'd like to be 6'3", and it just sort of sets on the shelf, you know? But, you know, I got that call, and it didn't really land. It didn't really hit me. I was like, oh, wow, cool. Because they're like, you're going to be in Sundance. And there's like, you know, there's like 120 films in Sundance. Mm-hmm. So like, well, I, you know, maybe I'll be like a best thing that's nonsense that's under 2 hours. You know what I mean? Like, what category? And then a few days later, it's like, no, your film's going to be in competition, which I think there's only like 16 or 18 films. Wow. in competition. And even at that point, there's such a process in making a movie, right? And it's been like a year of like every day. So in one sense, it was kind of like a cool, awesome next thing in a series of awesome things that had been going back for some period of time. But you know when it really hit me, man? Was the next year when the films for Sundance were announced. And to just kind of step to the side and realize, like, oh my gosh, right? Like, I was one of those films. It was, again, humbling and thrilling, you know? Like,
well, I think, you know, it's a pat on the back for, and it's lovely that you celebrate your whole team and crew and everyone that was part of it, because I think people don't realize when you just see yourself, like you say, sitting here on the couch, there was a whole team of people that actually, you know, were part of the process, yeah, that made it happen. But the greatest thing is you started it. But what's so great is that it's, you just made something into something else, and then it just became bigger than, you know, your capacity that you could possibly think of, which is fantastic.
Right. It goes back to what I was saying earlier. Like, you know, I said that script was really personal to me, really not precious, but just personal.
Yeah.
Like, it could not have been written by anyone else, because no one else has had my life or experience or my thoughts or, right, like, what I think is funny or sad or romantic or anything. And then to have communicated that to other people, again, like, diminishes the artistic isolation.
Yeah.
You know, where, like, I say, I feel this, and I share it with you, and you say, yes, I feel that too. And then there's like a sense of communion.
Yeah.
That for me is what's most important, more than a film festival or money or praise or anything. That connection that we can, that golden thread, I suppose.
Well,
that binds us together in art.
I mean, John, what I love about you is you're so, you know, have such an inspiring voice and such great with words. You should be a screenwriter or something, I don't know. But no, it's, what's so great is that, you know, you are also, you know, very highly celebrated in Los Angeles, and that you actually work in one of the best studios, you know, acting studios, you know, in the city.
Yep.
Which is absolutely fantastic, and offer your amazing teaching. Tell us a bit more about the studio that you work with and the stuff that you do.
Okay. Deb Aquila, who cast my movie, she and Donna Morong, another terrific casting director, decided to start an acting studio. They had studied with very famous teachers, in various disciplines, and wanted to help actors to do what we're talking about here, which is like access that creative self and help them to become a character and a storyteller in a way that would be effective and meaningful for them. Mm-hmm. Not result oriented, not about getting the job, not about getting a star on the Walk of Fame, but just freeing yourself up creatively. And you know, since they're such terrific casting directors who have worked so long in the business,
incredible, yeah.
They've come in contact with so many actors who were great, and so they see like, oh well, what do they have in common? Like, what is it that they're doing? And then people who could be, and what is it that's keeping them from that? So you know, to their infinite credit, they decided to open a studio, and the Aquila Wrong Studio for Actors, and Deb was nice enough to ask me to come and teach with her, and it seriously has been the most creatively rewarding experience of my life.
Wow, I mean, that's
hands down.
I mean, I think it has such a wonderful reputation here in Los Angeles. You know, how important do you think it is for an actor to be in class in Los Angeles?
Well, you heard me say earlier that I'm no good on my own.
Yeah.
And you know, one of the things that we do at the Aquila Wrong Studio is put forth a couple of ideas. One, that it's all about glacial progress. That all you have to do is be a little bit better today than you were yesterday. So it's, again, we're not about like getting the job or booking the role or anything like that. It's just, it's that creative drive, right?
Yeah.
And that's a group process. That's a group process. And you can't have a group process unless you have a group. And like, you need a group that you can trust that has a shared interest, a common goal. Mm-hmm. And we have that. And so when you're in class with us, our goal is to use great pieces of material, like terrific plays, in order to uncover the obstacles to your creative growth.
Yeah.
So as opposed to like just pats on the back, it's like, what's keeping you from fully expressing yourself? How can we help? And so toward that end, we're all in it together.
Yeah.
Right? Like the teachers and the students, you know, even that sort of implies a kind of hierarchy that I don't believe should exist and does exist in mm-hmm. in our studio. We're all in it together trying to like just get you to like express, you know, this terrific part in Stop Kiss, this fantastic moment in All My Sons, you know, mm-hmm, this mm-hmm. great monologue in Long Day's Journey and Tonight.
It's fantastic, and you know, everyone I know that has had the privilege of working with you is just, you know, just so happy and so, you know, so dedicated to the process of actually meandering in to find it, yeah. what it is, and I love that of being a little bit better than yesterday.
That's right.
So, I mean, again, it's like, it's great when your journey sort of feeds in so many different ways, and that, you know, but there is something going on. You have some projects lined up. Is that right?
Mm-hmm. You know, I spoke earlier about, and I keep banging the same nail, because I think that it's important, because it took me a while to recognize it, that there's more than one avenue that you can go down and be creatively satisfied.
Yeah.
So it's not just like, oh, I have to make movies or I am not going to be happy. Yeah. If that's the case, then you're doomed. Or I have to do this, or I have to, there's just so many different ways that you can express yourself. And I've been thankful. I'm lucky to have found so many, whether it's teaching or writing or directing or the play that I'm directing right now or the next play that I'm going to direct. And at the Aquila Wrong Studio, I'm so fortunate, you know. I just met so many terrific, committed, like-minded artists. And one of them, Hal Osan, who you know, terrific actor, encouraged me to...
he's a Brit, too. We're getting around, yeah.
He is. You guys are taking over again.
Oh, no, it's terrible. I love it. Oh, I shouldn't say that. I love it.
We made a movie. We made a movie, and it's in post-production right now. And it doesn't suck. It doesn't suck. And I know that that sounds like kind of lame, but that's really my goal all the time. Like, it's hard to not suck.
I think people, like, I think that's a really important point, because I feel like we're almost in a place where we're, as artists, we're never quite fully satisfied.
Sure.
And even people look, go up there and have their films celebrated, there's still always that need to actually, well, I want to do more. I want to improve. I want to make sure it's okay.
Yeah.
You know, and does that ever go away?
Well, that's that great Martha Graham quote, which I'm going to blow, but she talks about how, like, you know, that we're never satisfied. What we have is a queer dissatisfaction.
Yeah.
You know, just like an uneasiness. Like, it can always be, like, a little bit better. I think the film is terrific, and I would not have made it were I not to have stumbled into this terrific collection of artists. It's being edited right now by a guy named Brad McLaughlin, who's one of the editors on Star Wars. Just like all these great
that
people.
That tiny movie, yeah.
Yeah. Just all these great people who just wanna communicate from here. Just wanna share a really good story.
Well, and I we're all excited to see. Do we have a title yet, or is it still working?
It's called The Passing Parade.
The Passing Parade. Okay. Well, we're excited to watch that. You've given so many pieces of advice. Like I didn't feel this question is valid, but you know, I think it's so great because you just really given a sort of, you know, your experiences of just that, please never give up and please find your life and please find direction. But for anyone that, you know, is out there either working in the industry, trying to find their path, looking to come into it, what kind of like summary piece of advice do you have for them if they want to break out into this creative craziness?
Yeah, I think... I mean, I've been working with actors, and I've been teaching class in one way or another for 16 years. And what I like to tell people is, you're an expert. Like, you're an expert. You're an expert in areas that you dismiss because we constantly take away our own achievements. We say, oh well, if I did it, it must be easy, or if I care about it, it's not a big deal. And I don't agree with that. I'm not talking about an expert in like marksmanship or, you know, swimming. I'm talking about, I'm an expert on standards, right? Like on like those great the great American songbook. I'm an expert on movie monsters. I'm an expert on, romantic love. It's a hill I'm ready to die for like 24/7. So like, what are those things, those fundamental building blocks that make you you, like specifically you, different from everybody else? And they're usually the things that you keep hidden or that you dismiss, but I'm telling you, if you can like, and this is where the courage comes in, if you can focus on those, what makes you special, not better than, but different and unique, and mind that. I swear to God, like all the earth that you're gonna need to plant your creative seeds are right there. And if you're coming from that place, that unique place, then you will be seen as unique. And what is unique is valuable.
Wow, That's I'm ready to go off of my life for the rest of my life now. I mean, that
don't
was,
do that. We need you. We need you right here on the couch.
Oh, of course. I'll stay right here. No, John, that's wonderful. And it's been such a pleasure to have you tell us your stories and just the fact that you've just all, I think everybody watching is going to go out there to now and go, I'm going to do this. I've got it.
I hope so. I do. I really hope that.
Well, we certainly thank you for all of yourself and your great achievements and your great words of wisdom, and it's been such an honor to have you here today.
Thank you so much, John, for having me. Thank you. I really appreciate it.
You're very welcome. Thank you.